Peter.
It's late for me, dude.
It's really late for you right now. Like over 24 hours.
Okay.
No, take your time.
No.
It's all good.
I've taken my time.
Here we go.
Thank you.
All right, that's the one.
Okay.
That was a good ending.
Sorry.
That was good, man.
Thanks for hanging in there.
That was good.
Well, we're trying to figure it out. Peter went to the bathroom like 4 times. I got to use the bathroom.
I was like, what do you do when you're waiting for us to drink water?
Drink water, go to the bathroom.
I mean, what can I say? Greatness takes time.
Oh, sorry.
That wasn't great. We can still do better.
Yeah. Oh, wait, hold on.
Well, great and greater.
Wait, this is the chord I really wanted to play.
Oh.
But it sounded nice.
Yeah, it was a good ending. For sure.
Yeah, it came together.
Did it. Finally, yeah.
So, we got Peter Moreros with us today.
Woo!
Builder of Cornerstone Ukes.
Master Luthier.
Thanks for joining us, Peter.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
How are you doing? Sorry it's so late.
It's great. It's great.
You've probably been up for like
it's later
100 hours or something.
Exactly.
So talk about these latest deliveries.
Oh, okay. Well, this one I'm sure you guys have seen it similar before on my Tularosa series. It was pretty successful, I thought. And I had a lot of people requesting more of the tenors, but I promised to be three and three only. So we stuck with three. And then it was a great opportunity to redesign or come up with a new design for the baritone. And I thought that would be a great way to introduce the new baritone and make another series of three. So there's one more being built and another one that I also completed. Again, same combination, black and white ebony, black stained 5A mahogany neck, and then with the matching white turquoise inlays, headstock, rosette, following the theme of the Tularosa tribe, Anasazi from New Mexico. New bevel,
I love the bevel.
Thank you.
Very sleek.
Yeah, I felt for the baritone, it'd probably be nice to have a little something that covers more real estate in case the player plays in different areas of the soundboard. So I cover that whole upper area of the lower bout. As far as the rest, just. A new take at the baritone, Cornerstone. I've built a couple baritones before, but they were a completely different design, and I just like the tidal waist, so I went back to...
Oh, that's right, so it's like you took the waist and moved it
and
narrowed it?
Yeah, a little bit. It's basically very close to the tenor as far as the proportions of the waist and the lower bout and the very round lower bout and the tight waist, I kind of like that.
Is the upper bout, it is wider, right, than a regular tenor?
Yes, bounce. Yes, when yes. You,
of course.
When you mentioned it, it doesn't look like it from this angle, which is cool. It doesn't...
Yeah, it looks like a baritone. What is that, 20-inch scale, right?
It's 20 and a quarter.
Okay.
Nice.
20 and a quarter inch scale.
Yes. I really like the sound. I mean... Thank you. I put a set of Kolau Aho strings on that. Hope you don't mind.
No, I actually like them a lot. I've never heard of them. Definitely something to consider.
Yeah.
Beautiful. This
is, yeah, it's... I don't know. Corey, give your thoughts.
I mean, hands down, one of the best, if not the best, baritone. Like, we were talking earlier, and it's nothing bad against any other brand, but... last week we played a couple Petros ukuleles. It wasn't a baritone, but we did get a couple baritones in before, and that was like the king of all baritones. Now it's like Peter's like, yeah, we'll check out my baritone.
Yeah, I know, that's what, well, yeah. Kalei said that earlier to me, and I'm just like, we would have to have them here because it's like hard to remember it exactly is. You know, in comparisons, but then I do remember, and I could, you know, kind of compare some of the aspects of it, but what I can say that I really love about this is that it retains a beautiful articulation.
Yeah, the overall tonal balance is—it's amazing. Yeah. I mean, I've run out of words to describe what I hear in my look.
That's dope.
I don't even get to see it yet.
give me a little bit more spins on that. Such a nice piece.
Oh.
And what is this? This wood is like a million years old or something?
Yeah. Close to. Yeah, 2850. So almost 3,000 years.
Jeez.
Man, I like how the black and white ebony has some sort of curl going on.
Yes,
it
does have a
little bit of curl. That is some of the nicest black and white.
This piece has more of the lighter wood, which is cool. Is it? The ones that we had, there's a lot more like black spider webbing that goes through.
But it's similar to the Tula Rosa series that we had from you, but this one has some super psychedelic grain going on there.
Yeah, the curl actually, it's noticeable. A little bit of curl on the back and sides.
Mm-hmm. Well-defined lines. Nice. Cool. If nobody knew what this wood was, they would be surprised to know that it's ebony.
Nice flame maple neck.
What was the mahogany saddle again?
It's oxbone.
Oxbone.
Wait, yeah. Is the neck is maple, right?
Yeah, five-way maple, yeah, curly maple.
And then one piece. Nice little artsy choice to like do the mismatch on the tuner.
Yeah, I was trying to carry on the theme of the black and white, black on white, and do as much black and white contrast as I could.
Ebony ivory.
Right.
So, unfortunately, nobody gets this uke except me.
Yeah, all these jobs you work are... let me get individual sound samples for both of you guys on it.
I'll go first, or...
Okay. Yeah.
I'm just going to do some noodling. Stop playing, but realize I'm just like, can you
wrap it up?
Can you end?
Yeah, but I mean, I feel your sentiment. It's something you could noodle with for ever.
I think it has a built-in sustain pedal.
It has built-in reverb too.
Yeah, it has all the effects. And you hit it hard enough, it has like chorus.
Yeah, you make such a big sounding boomy tenor that I was afraid your baritone would be too boomy, but it's not. It's actually perfect. Yeah.
Thank you.
Sounds like an exotic wood. Too boomy. This is some too boomy wood.
Too boomy back and sides.
Yeah. Before we you guys could do a flip flop on it. No. But first, let me get an individual sound sample because this is a new Alcoa.
Actually, tenor. I found out it's Australian.
Oh, Blackwood. Yes, that's right.
Tasmanian Blackwood.
I knew that too, and I don't know why. I'm just looking from here, and I just like my brain says Koa. So, is this Tasmanian Blackwood or Australian Blackwood?
Yeah, same. It's the same thing. Tasmanian right. Or Australian is the same thing.
Okay, sometimes. Yeah.
Yeah, it's Tasmanian Blackwood.
That thing is powerful.
My brain is not at 100% right now.
Sorry.
It's all right.
Nor is neither are ours.
Put that down so I don't make any noise. We dream of doing a podcast midday when we're like fresh.
When everyone's fresh, right? I have something to say.
What? Give me a twirl on that guy.
Go check this out.
Talk about some of the features.
So this features some very beautiful Australian blackwood, which comes from the acacia family. Just
call it Australian koa.
Or Australian koa. So Australian blackwood or Australian koa.
No, don't call it Australian koa.
I remember I first heard that from you back at like the store with the McPherson's.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because there was a blackwood one. I remember you telling me, oh, this is kind of like Australian koa.
Yeah, but
Andrew.
Andrew. But it was so long ago.
You get in trouble for that.
Andrew, you have to tell him.
Shame.
Don't do it as I say. Do as I tell you. So.
I'm trying to put it back on me for some 10-year-old conversation.
That's why I was like, because it's. Yeah. I consider it like basically.
Corey,
you have to call it
Australian.
Australian. Australian.
Australia.
Australian. And so we have this tenor was built out of some very beautiful Australian blackwood, and we almost mistook it for koa, which is because look at the grain on this.
It looks like koa.
Basically, it looks the same.
Australian koa.
If there's kidding. No, if no one told me that that's what it was made out of, I wouldn't have known. It's beautiful. I like all of the appointments that that comes with it. This green theme is very nice. I like how we have it on the rosette. We got it on the fretboard and the faceplate as well. It sounds really nice and warm, deep, has a lot of volume. So this is great for those of you who are looking for something with more projection, along with very rich, thick overtones that come through with this beautiful instrument. Mahogany neck. And I really like how these usually come with some kind of like dark to light finish here on the necks. They're very beautiful. And looks to be, is this a rosewood backplate?
Macassar
ebony backplate. And these are outfitted with Goto SX510 tuners. Very nice and smooth, easy to tune, very reliable. And yeah, comes all in one awesome package, this beautiful tenor.
Can I say one thing? That shirt really matches that ukulele. Like,
it just needs to be green. If it was green. T-shirts not included.
I love how the green, though, it's like the forest colored. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a nice, I like that. Chrysocolla on stone, it's beautiful. Yeah.
Amazonian green. That one also has built-in reverb.
I know. I was like, where was it? It's like when I played higher up, it just came through. Oh, there it was.
Yeah. So, amazing. Peter, since the last time you were here, I think you changed your finish process, right?
Yes. I went to a full UV cure polyester.
How's that been? How was the learning curve for that?
Yeah, there was some learning curve, just like anything else. It's a great product. It's very clear, very hard, very resistant. But it's probably the clearest finish I've ever seen in any instrument. It's like glass. I absolutely love it. Yeah, it's beautiful stuff. You can go. It's very resistant, so you can go very thin on the finish, and it's resistant to solvents. Gasoline, alcohol, acetone, anything you want to put on it. So I like that. But primarily it's resistant to acids from your body. Mm-hmm. Long-term use from your arm, sweat.
Yeah, sure.
So
nitrocellulose definitely can wear
right.
down in ways that it doesn't. What was the investment on that switch like?
It was substantial.
Yeah. It is expensive.
Emotional
right?
investment or, right, right. or financial?
Was there an emotional investment?
Yeah, it was a little stressful at first. Yeah, anytime you try something different.
Did you have to build like your own UV booth to?
No, actually, Cure. I have a special booth that doubles as a bathroom. I'm serious.
Oh,
but
really?
I cure by hand with a handheld UV light. And you got to suit up. You got to suit up and put all that. Mask and helmet and all that.
Dang.
Protecting it, yeah. And then you just get a lamp and spend a few minutes sweating in the bathroom, basically.
Oh, that's wild.
Super. Yeah. Is it like really hot? Is it like?
It gets pretty hot, but it's not so much the heat, even though you can get up to like over 200 degrees. So you got to keep it moving, not too close to the instrument. But it's so bright. It's like third degree exposure, sunburns in a matter of seconds if you're not protected. Yeah.
Wow.
But the finish cures all the way through. I mean, majority of finishes, I mean, even if you look at polyurethanes and urethanes, not to mention nitrocellulose lacquer, which is even worse, but those finishes never really cure. They take months, weeks, months, even years sometimes to cure fully all the way through.
Yeah.
And this finish, in a matter of 10 minutes, it's fully cured, as hard as it'll get. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that gives me a little bit of a time advantage because I'm able to just get it done right away.
What are the worst thing you, I guess you don't like about UV, if there's anything?
Well, in the summer, I don't like to put that suit on and sweat to death. I mean, literally, I have to wear a sweater and one of those Tyvek suits and a welding helmet and big gloves. And you have to be completely covered head to toe. Wow.
That light mm-hmm. would be like a gnarly weapon.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, it's very, very powerful, very, very bright. So that's one of the downfalls. I'm going to have an oven eventually. I just don't have a place to put it. Just stick it in there and push a button and let it do its thing and rotates the instrument. But right now I don't have a place to put it out of room.
It's funny. I imagine like you're putting on the suit and stuff, and then like you're ready. You're like, whoa, this guy's going to go into some kind of like radioactive spaceship layer. Yeah. Something. Yeah. But he just has an ukulele.
No COVID in there, that's for sure.
Oh, kills everything. Kills
everything. Building a bomb or...
Exactly. A good thing is, so you have a great product, very thin, very crystal clear, diamond clear, like glass.
Cures in 10 minutes.
Cures very fast. It's resistant to solvents, and all the bacteria in the instrument has been killed. A lot of advantages.
That's awesome. Sterilizes the instrument as well as your entire bathroom. Right. Never have to clean again.
Pre-sterilized.
So where do you get that? What is it? How big is that device?
So light? There's different sizes that you can get a lamp. So basically it's a handheld, like maybe 6-8 inches with a light in there. But then there's another... what is that called? Power supply, big power supply.
Oh, to run that type
to
of...
To run that,
oh,
yeah.
Okay. What kind of, like, wattage or voltage is?
Yeah, it runs on 110, some 220. Wow. Mine is 110, but it's like 1,200 watts or something like that.
Holy moly. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
And then what electricity spectrum? Bill gone off?
I haven't noticed much of it. I mean, it's only a few minutes. I mean, I only do that a couple times a month, once or twice a month.
Just running a high-powered microwave.
Yeah, but it's... I mean, everything that I use right now, and that's one of the reasons, because I don't want instruments sitting in my shop for weeks and collecting dust, which makes it really hard. I just wanted to be able to get it done, right? And this allows me that time advantage. But it's everything. It's the sealer. It's UV cured. And then the pore fill is UV cured. And then the finish. So in between every step, I have to suit up and cure, take it off, sand, spray, and then cure. To go through the whole process again. So it's a bit of a pain, but I think the results are really good.
Mm. Whereas, yeah, like, if you were to do, like, a nitro finish, because Ryan...
Yeah, they'll be sitting for weeks, right? Yeah,
right, afterwards.
Go in and sand it, and then do another layer and sand, and then more sanding, and then three weeks pass by, and you're like, Ryan, where's my
Right.
But then, yeah, at the end of all that, letting it sit for another, you know, 2 to 3 weeks...
I mean, the labor is the
still,
same.
You know, gassing off a little bit. Right, you know? I mean, it will be for a little while, like you said, but yeah.
And the labor is the same. I mean, doing a nitro, polyurethane, polyester is about the same amount of time. It's just I don't have to let it sit for weeks. Once I'm done spraying and it's done, it's 10 minutes, it's cured. Then it's just a matter of level sanding and buffing, and it's ready to go.
What's the spectrum of light, I guess, energy or for that handheld?
I think it's UVA. I don't remember anymore.
Also, it can.
It's UV.
Like third degree.
Oh yeah, yeah. If you get exposed to that, you get massive third degree. I
think like your eyes opening. Oh my god.
I don't remember exactly what the ratio is anymore, but I think like 1 minute of exposure is equivalent to like a few hours of direct sunlight. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's insane.
Right.
Cancer.
Yeah, exactly.
Don't catch it. We need you to build my
No, you just got to stay suited up.
Yes, I just suit up. I won't build in the summer when it's hot. I just build in the winter.
No.
Take the summers off.
We need you to build
it. Take the summers off. No, I really love the product. It's funny because I helped a friend of mine with, he had a problem ukulele, and we had to refinish his headstock. And of course, he didn't have the time to redo everything again and wait the amount of weeks it takes for the finish to cure and all that stuff.
It's cool, because you're only a one-man shop, and you have, you're trying to
right
pump them out as fast as possible, so
right
it kind of matches your right workflow and style, right?
Hey, hey, he doesn't pump them out as fast as possible. Carefully crafted into
right.
Spending a million hours on each.
Yes, close.
And then
to
towards
it
the end, you pump in UV rays, disinfecting, yes, sterilizing.
Yes, yeah. But you get the best of both worlds. But yeah, like I was saying, that we refinished this headstock, and one of the things that he noticed is the clarity of the finish. It's so much more clear, and more like that, more like glass,
transparent.
Even before,
yeah.
It's a great product.
Yeah, they've been looking amazing. Any other changes to your
There's
shop?
Always changes. That and I think that's probably the first or the second that's got a little bit of a change in the bracing
oh, yeah? What'd you do?
System. I guess you'll have to look inside.
Well, you gotta
you'll have to buy it and look.
All right.
I mean it's still the same
Secret
principle.
Sauce.
It's just I've changed a couple of braces, the way the length, the height, the thickness, and the orientation a little bit. I believe there's always, you should learn from what you do and not settle. I think there's a little bit of room to get things better. And so I made a couple of changes.
How do you test out things like that?
Well, I see after the instrument is built, string it up, I can see how the top flexes, how it reacts. How it reacts if you put a little bit of weight on it, take some weight off of it. You know, you can feel a big difference in sound when you put your hand on the soundboard. The soundboard is alive when you're playing, right? So if you dampen the sound a little bit, you can see areas that could affect more of the sound. And then I just change the orientation of the braces, maybe a little bit longer, shorter, taller, things like that.
You know what's crazy? Earlier when I was restringing the baritone, because it's string through bridge, right? And you all of your braces are carved out.
Right.
So
you went through a brace?
I did accidentally. Like I fed it through, and then like, you know, you make the tie and you pull it back. I didn't notice until I started stringing it up, and I look in and it's like caught from the end is like in the brace rather than pulled back to the anyways. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, I've done it before.
Yeah.
I know exactly what you're talking about.
I was like, oh, that could have been bad if I just, you know, wasn't paying attention.
Pull a brace with it.
Yeah. But it's not a common thing because, it has to be a string through bridge and you have to have the type of braces there.
Right.
But anyways, yeah, something to watch out for, I guess, if you're
right
restringing. We got what are the woods on this one that we got a few weeks ago?
It's curly mahogany, torrified spruce, maybe?
Oh, let's compare these two tone woods with like a little bit of a minute on each.
Andrew, if you don't mind, let me take a look at it. Let me see if I have the new bracing system on that one or not. That'll be a good way to tell. No, this one isn't.
Changed
the couple of the braces got changed. Yeah, so this is the old bracing pattern. That one's the new one.
It'd be interesting. It's not a pure wood comparison.
Right, it wouldn't be a fair comparison, but.
But yeah, we'll compare the two just for comparison.
Sorry, that was me.
Yeah.
That's a pretty nice Tasmania Blackwood, huh, Andrew?
Yeah. Yeah, it's gorgeous.
I got 20 sets of that. I got lucky. Nice stuff.
Yeah, this is premium curl.
Nice stuff.
Love the green.
I like it too.
Like it.
I mean, this blue is a really nice blue too.
Just the blue stands out. The green stands out better. Better contrast.
It stands out better. It's got its like that kind of like really rootsy look to it.
Right. It looks good on core.
Yeah.
Sounds good.
That's a buff sounding ukulele. Very strong.
Yeah. So let me let's swap a Roni. What's your favorite wood to build with?
Me?
Yeah.
I don't have a favorite. Tell the truth. I'm a wood nut. I like all. I love black and white ebony. I like koa. Both not the easiest woods to work with.
Yeah, the black and white ebony is so dense. You usually have to like
hard to bend, hard to dry, hard to season, sand bend.
Let me get a sample from you.
Okay.
And yeah, what are your thoughts just initially?
With great power comes great responsibility. This is a really incredible baritone. And I think it was just last night Corey and I were talking about saying, imagine a cornerstone baritone, and then like little did we know that there was going to be one featured here tonight, and I'm just like really excited. It sounds incredible. One thing I like about this is that everything comes out nice and clear. So usually with a lot of baritones, because they have so much bottom end, they end up coming out too warm, a little bit too mid-range kind of sound. And but not with this. You get a lot of the characteristics that you would expect from a baritone and more. There's a lot to do with the way it's braced, built, type of finish, and you got some really high quality woods on here. I mean, this is almost 3,000 year old spruce on the top and black and white ebony, and it's always a trip to be able to see woods like these. And I mean, it's an incredible ukulele.
Yeah. God said, ask and you shall receive. And then he said, for the last time, Corey, my name is Peter, not...
Oh my God. It's like everything sounds good on it, so it makes it hard to decide what to play.
I can't. Right?
Alright, let's see.
Okay. It's like the Super Bowl for noodles.
It's a good analogy. Great analogy for you.
I just want to do noodles all day.
Come with like a warning addictive label.
Warning, this product creates extreme happiness.
It's extremely addicting.
All right.
belongs on a CD. So,
record
that CD. That's gonna be on there.
How hard would it be for a builder to get these woods?
I mean, black and white ebony, there's some around. I mean, it's not that hard to get. It's just
the ancient spruce.
Ancient spruce. You know, I have a few sets. I don't know if there's any more around or not.
It's pretty rare stuff, though.
Yeah, it is rare. It's one tree only, just like the tree. And once it's gone, it's gone. And it's highly collectible wood, I'm sure. Black and white ebony. I've seen a good amount of it. It's just it's such a temperamental wood. It's very hard
to work with.
But more than anything, it's very hard to dry, because the black and the white, they dry at different rates, so they kind of pull against each other. So there's a lot of cracks and splits. So to get a piece big enough that you can get backs and sides and be able to dry it and not having any problems, there's a lot of waste.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I got a nice big board, I had to resaw it, and it's hard to keep it straight. It's hard to dry it. It's a bit of a pain to work with. But just like anything else, the harder it is to work with, normally the nicer it tends to be. It's great beautiful. Sound, great projection, beautiful wood. Yeah.
That's what I say about Corey.
Yeah.
The end product is good, though.
It takes a while to get there, right? Got to massage it.
Greatness takes time.
All right, settle down.
Sometimes we never know where we're going in life.
Oh. And other times we do.
Teach us more.
Just like how I don't know where we're going to go with every song.
Same here.
It's a journey. And it's fun.
Enjoy the ride.
It's an adventure.
How's your trip to Hawaii been? Well, your daughter
just
kind
got
of
here. Got... My daughter's not feeling very well, so that was kind of a bummer, because she wanted to come here and check this out, and instead she's alone at the condo. But I got here 11 in the morning. You know, long day, long flight.
Yeah.
Lots of traffic, so I got the full
I should have Honolulu scheduled you experience. Later.
I got a full Honolulu experience early in the morning, you know, throughout the afternoon.
In what way?
What's traffic.
Terrible traffic.
Traffic, and they closed some street for the Veterans Parade.
Oh, no.
Pretty soon there's going to be a rail, and there's not going to be any more traffic.
Yeah, right. No.
Nah.
There's going to be a lot of traffic created because of the construction.
We have some issues, but...
No, I love it here.
It's beautiful.
Glad to be here. I'm very happy to be here with you guys. A great opportunity.
Thank you for being here.
Thank you for joining us.
It's great. I always enjoy it. I try to make this a tradition. Try to come every year. A couple times a year.
Heck
visit
yeah.
you guys, other people, bring some instruments.
Yeah.
Come back to my roots and the ukulele roots, and it's all good. I love it.
Yeah. Have you been back to Portugal?
I was there about 4 years ago.
Mm.
Yeah. But not since. I'll go again eventually, just far.
I would love to visit. Looks beautiful.
It's nice, very nice. Hawaii kind of reminds me. It's like a more laid back, chill. No one's in a hurry. Portugal, no one's in a hurry. Really, no one's in a hurry. Perfect place to build musical instruments. You have, because you know you need to take your time. Take your time.
Wow, I like that.
I mean, 100 years ago when the Portuguese migrated over, you know. My grandma's side of the family, they probably came over and were like, "All right, this is perfect."
Yeah, no one's in a hurry.
Like, did we really go anywhere?
No, I love it here. Like I told you guys, I love to move here. I love it here. I really do.
Yeah, you were telling me last time you were here, you're not 100% on California anymore.
Right, right.
You
still on the fence.
Yeah,
still on the fence.
We'll it's always see. Easier to stay where you are.
Yeah. It's change is hard. Moving is hard.
Yeah, it's the worst.
But California's hard, and it's crowded, you know, and there's a lot of reasons. Financial reasons, space reasons, health reasons.
Where's your...
Mostly mental health.
Yeah.
Don't we all need better mental health?
Yes.
But for health reasons, you would stay there? Like,
no, for health reasons, I would leave.
Oh, I got you.
I mean, you don't know what that traffic does to me, man. It drives me crazy.
What part are you in exactly?
Southern California, Huntington Beach area.
Okay, yeah.
It's not that bad. It's not L.A., but...
No, it's nice there. I've spent a little bit
of time. It's beautiful there. I love it there. But, you know, change is good. You know, sometimes a fresh start, it's a good thing.
Yeah. Come to Hawaii. It's so much cheaper over
here. No, I know. Hey, gas is cheaper for sure.
I know. What's up with that? How does that? That's so weird.
You guys must get some bulk discount or something.
I guess so.
Maybe because we're in the middle of the ocean. I don't know.
I put gas at Costco the other day, and I'm like, oh, wait, this is just normal prices here. $4.86.
I think California just taxes everything so much more.
Yeah, see, that's one reason.
Yeah,
it's expensive in California. It's getting really expensive.
Yeah, it kind of is everywhere, but...
Yeah. We'll see. We'll see what happens.
Okay.
Hawaii up on my list, but we'll see.
Yeah.
Never say never.
Be funny.
Can do Big Island and live off the grid in Puna. Oh, yeah. Build a workshop there.
You won't have traffic.
You won't really have anything there.
No, no electricity.
You know, barely even a cell phone signal.
Oh, perfect. Off the grid completely.
Yeah.
So are you going from here over to...
No, I'm going back home.
Oh, you're going back home.
For a couple of days, yeah.
And then to Laos and...
Yeah, you're going to go have a little vacation for a little while?
I'm going to go hunting for some exotic woods.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Cool.
You going to travel vlog it for us?
I'm not much of a vlogger.
I know, right?
If you guys see my internet presence, which I try to be present, but, you know, I like to show what I can deliver, not how I got there, you know, because I think it's more important. I think people like to see the end result at the end of the day. And some steps, I like to show progress, but a lot of the other stuff, it's so time-consuming, you know. It's so hard to come up with, personally, designs, ideas, concepts. That takes a lot of time, and I'd rather use that time to design stuff and come up with ideas that can make my stuff better. You know, taking pictures of jigs and routers, you know, it takes the same amount of time, and it doesn't help me in my building, right? And so there's a lot of, I mean, you guys see, there's a lot of drawing and a lot of designs and a lot of things that I don't spend as much time as I should, because it takes a lot of time. You know, a lot of times I spend 4, 5, 6 hours sitting in front of the computer, and then I kind of have to walk away and then come back and take another take at it, and time-consuming stuff.
I mean, we can tell.
Yeah.
I mean, the end product is beautiful.
Thank you.
It's a masterpiece.
Definitely is.
Corey, give us a sample on this Australian Blackwood tenor.
I kind of kicked the mic a little bit. Okay. Sustain up here, which is nice, giving you that that kind of natural reverb kind of feel.
But it's not just like that sustaining from the high notes, like the whole body of the instrument,
the whole thing just comes alive.
Yeah,
even up here too, it's like,
yeah, you don't lose any tone or sustain when you're playing up there.
Yeah, that's a pretty incredible. All the way up here.
That's usually where like most ukuleles like tend to start thinning out. Is once you get past like the 10th fret, it's like, but man, it still sounds the same. It's like even notes, like going all the way up and back down.
Yeah, this would be a really good classical ukulele because of the sustain you get and the just really balanced tone. It'll deliver whatever you need.
How do you describe your bracing? Like, what would you say it's in the...
I would say it's Kasha inspired, mm-hmm. even though it's nothing like Kasha. But he started out as a modified Kasha because I have a sound hole, right? So I couldn't do a full Kasha bracing. And there's a few things that I particularly didn't like because of the way I built, right? Nothing wrong with Kasha. I think it's probably one of the best bracing systems out there. But I just needed to change it a little bit because I like a little bit warmer, and I needed to accommodate the sound hole, so I made some changes there. But then, so I would call it modified Kasha when I started. Now I don't think it's... It was Kasha inspired, but I don't think it's anything like Kasha anymore. It kind of evolved to the point that I've changed enough that is...
it's not even Kasha it's hybrid. Even Kasha. It's just like right. something.
It's something, you know.
Cornerstone bracing.
Exactly. It's just seeing the needs, you know, when I build. That's why I like, you know, I know you guys don't like titanium strings. The Dara titaniums.
Oh, I like them.
Yeah, me too.
I like to stay with the same strings just because I can, if I change strings, then I don't know what's causing the change, right? So if every instrument has the same strings, that's not a factor anymore. I can't say, well, maybe the strings are making a difference in the sound. So as I build, I always listen, try to see, okay, what happened here? What can I do better? And of course, I don't know if I'm going to change it again. But I didn't know if I was going to change it again last time that I changed it. But yeah, if I see a need, you know, some more figure woods like redwoods and curly Port Orford cedars, they tend to be a little more temperamental, move more. So that forced me to change bracing a little bit just to accommodate those types of woods. And it's a gradual process. But I would say that it Kasha inspired and eventually took on its own form.
Well, do you see yourself getting, like, because you're pretty deep in the technology aspect of building too. Do you want to go further in that direction? Is there areas to automate further?
I mean, I don't want to say that I want to automate as much as I want to use. I don't look at tech as a automation type of a vessel, but more of being able to get me to do things that otherwise I couldn't do. Because there's certain things that they're almost impossible to do by hand, that CNC machines or laser cutters allow you to do. Right, I mean, I could carve a brace by hand and hollow it out, but I could never get that brown caramelized sealed wood that the laser leaves behind. Right, it seals the wood. It looks good. Right, so there's certain things that you can do with high tech. But for me, one of the things that really helped me when I started designing the ukulele from a high tech perspective was not so much the build aspect of it. Right. It was that I was able to see before I built it what I was aiming. I was able to lay it out in a 3D form and draw it out before I made it. Okay, how where's everything going to fit? How's everything going to look like? And so that kind of helped a lot. You know, because when you're looking at bridge placements and scale lengths, and there's only so much you can. I mean, you can do everything by hand, of course, but you'll never be as precise or as fast or have as much data as if you do it in a digital world, right, in a CAD CAM situation. So that kind of helped a lot to be able to draw something and before I build it and see, even send my customers a picture, hey, this is what I have in mind before doing it. That really, really helps a lot. So
did you get into CAD from guitar building?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. It was
did Kevin Ryan get you into that, or that was something you were
No, ready? That was something else. We use this in different programs. But actually, a friend of mine got me pointed in the direction. I used Rhino 3D. I tried SolidWorks and AutoCAD and other programs. So I kind of settled with Rhino. It's fairly easy, I would say, for me to use. But it allows me to lay out an instrument, a scale length, bridge positioning, string spacing, neck width. I mean, there's so much you can do. Because once you make it, and if you do it first before you draw it out, it's kind of hard to go back because you've invested so much time to do an actual instrument. This way allows me to kind of see before I start tackling it how it would look in the real world, how it would work. So from that point, I think technology is great. Then taking it to the next level, right? Things that you're able to do, precision. There's certain things like cutting fret slots, right? The way I do the necks, which are the fretboards, fret slots not cut all the way through, things that you couldn't do by hand. So CNC machine and laser allows you to do certain things with more precision, and even things that you possibly couldn't do by hand. So I think you have a little bit of an upper hand there.
Yeah, it's a different tool,
right,
in that respect.
It's just a tool. It's another tool.
But is that something you want to grow with? Is there more in that direction that you think you can get to?
Well, I don't know. If there was more, I probably would be doing it already.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I don't say no because I don't know. And absolutely would never say no because I'm always looking to if something's gonna, if I can make something better, if I figure out a way to make something
like
better.
Like Taylor's got the robot arm doing the finish, yeah, and stuff, you know. I mean, there's
always. Let me get one of those next year. Yeah, I mean, let me tell you something. If there's something I could automate, if I could automate finishing, trust me, that would be the first thing I would do.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah. Watch, 10 years, Peter's gonna build this machine. All you do is you turn it on, and it's gonna be like, please select your top wood. You're going to turn it in this machine.
Right.
Please select your backwoods. Right. Please select, all you do is select your materials, and then you have all this stuff, and just
push a button, ukulele comes out.
I don't think we're close.
Oh, Peter's going to do it. He's going to figure it out.
I'm going to figure it out.
The Ukulele Fabricator 9000.
Yes.
If anybody can do it.
Yes, I'll start working on it when I get home. No, there are things. I mean, automation. I mean, there's only so much you can automate, right? There's always a lot of handwork. But yes, if there's one thing I could if I could automate finishing, that's,
I mean, there's
sure.
So many other luthiers out there that share that sentiment because it's not
so many
close,
like,
to their favorite aspect of building.
So many, like all of them.
Yeah. Well. I don't know. There's probably some that
like it.
Get a little high off the fumes.
Off the fumes.
I don't know.
Maybe I've been in a good mood lately. I wonder if that's why. Solvent. Solvent high. It's legal.
Yeah, sometimes I feel like I might have a few too many brain cells, so I just have to take it down a little bit.
Exactly. Slow it down.
Yeah.
Too many ideas. Got to slow down a little bit.
So what's the future for, I guess, keep surprising us with gorgeous pieces?
Yeah, I mean, I wish I could tell what the future is. Obviously, I'm going to try to get better, right? Always trying to get better. I have a lot of ideas kind of up in the air. It's just not enough time to execute them. And it takes so long. You know, that's one of the things. I mean, it doesn't take me a whole lot of time to make something. I mean, a headstock of a nice tribal design. That doesn't, to make it, yeah, it takes a certain amount of time, but just to come up with the idea, put it on paper, execute it, just the initial, it.
And each instrument is like a concept.
Yeah, I mean, I try to. I mean, there are certain ones that I kind of like, and I kind of stick with it, and I use those a few times. I try to come up with something new every time, but that's one of the hardest things, coming up with something new. I mean, there's only so many ideas that one person can fish out of its head, and it's hard. It's hard to come up with ideas. So I think, for me at this point, I don't know what the future holds, but I definitely want to come up with more different ideas, just be able to show novelty in terms of design.
Yeah,
which is the hard part. Yeah,
I believe in you.
Thank you.
Keep coming with it.
I mean, everything that.
But you guys know that these things take a lot of work to make. You know, a lot of time, a lot of work, a lot of passion, a lot of sweat.
Greatness takes time.
You know.
Oh my goodness.
But yes, Corey, we know that.
For the last time, Corey.
Yes. Yeah. We know how long it took right. you to do the intro song. Takes time, but these are special, and yeah, congratulations in advance to the owners. Epic instruments.
And what did you guys give a technique of the week?
Which I put. What's a good technique? Oh, you know, like when we do the funk stuff, like that kind of the muting and the. That's like super technical.
Yeah,
there's like five techniques going off.
Yeah,
muting, string isolations, sliding,
pinching,
chunking, pinching.
Wow,
a lot of activities in this one. Did we go over bending? Did we ever do that?
No, we never went over bending.
We can do. It's kind of risky. A lot of risk is involved because you don't have the right string. You can't execute the step and a half bend. So you have.
It's hard
the,
on the nylon string.
Yeah, so you have the. You know, we're in C7. You have the regular full note bend, right? But then there's.
Nice
kind of. And then your string's out of tune. So you want to make sure you don't have a fresh set of strings. And the goal is really to bend the note to. Or bend the string up to that half a step more. So you have like C7, right? And you have your pentatonic. A lot of people, when they're doing like lead, they'll lead into a melody like this. They'll bend it up to this, which is, you know, this is on the 8th fret of the A string, but you can go a little bit further. This is where it gets tricky. And it works a lot better on electric guitars. Because the string tension is a lot lower, but you can get away with it on ukulele if you know, use a standard nylon set or fairly low tension string. So, another thing that's involved, you want to get the right tone, because if you don't get the right tone, you're not going to get the right feel across. So, like, you really want to dig into it. This is kind of like when you're playing bass, if you play bass. There's this a different style of slap bass, and it's not so much with your thumb,
it's the pluck.
The pluck, yeah. So you really want to get under the string, and if you look, my middle finger here, whenever I'm doing that kind of stuff, I'm really like gripping the string as much as I can, because you want to get that nice we were testing these strings and putting it to the limit. I don't want to break it, but yeah, the step and a half bend. That's what the lick is.
So if you break your strings doing this, then buy another set from us.
Oh, it's easier up here. I meant to last right. Tip. So because you're more at the middle of the string, there's less tension. So if you're playing in A, you can get away with that. String went flat, so
wow.
And that happens. And
you did it. You just had to go and do it.
So
that is the point where you're
be careful. Luckily,
what a fail.
So I'm gonna try it on the E string this time. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so definitely be careful when you're performing that. The bends.
Sorry, Andrew.
I hear him whining it. Let's see how far you can bend that one.
We'll do a less abrasive
do a half type a,
technique.
Half
so.
Tone bend. Let's see if you can do this.
Yeah, you're
going to
be going out of tune.
It's kind of
like.
He's afraid.
I just have this, like, this fear. That one day it's gonna break and then it's just gonna cut. Oh!
Oh my god, Corey committed suicide. No, it was just a string.
Like, oh, it's.
That's irrational.
Worst case scenario. Okay, so.
That's what would that phobia be?
String phobia. Okay, so this is kind of a funk technique Kelly and I like to use. And this is incorporating a lot of techniques. This is like you're getting a package. You're getting a combo. Because there's like four or five techniques involved. And it requires a lot of coordination, a lot of timing. So, you know, if you're going to try to tackle this, you want to break it down slowly. And then kind of work up.
Do some jumping get the, jacks.
Yeah.
The blood flowing.
So that we did that on last week's podcast. This is just over C7 and works very well in low G tuning because you're going to want to use that as like the Your note, that note is planted, and you're going to be using that. You're going to be alternating between the bottom part of the chord and that bass note. So it's like what a lot of guitar players do. And the technique slowly is. That's only one of 5 million different funk grooves. So what I'm doing is I'm plucking with my thumb, treating the G string as like a bass. And then the other three fingers. This is pretty crucial in this technique, because you get a very specific kind of sound. You could do the same kind of thing with strumming, but you're not going to get the same kind of feeling. As compared to... And what's also behind all that is you're keeping this rhythm. And I do a lot of this tapping here. So there's percussion involved. You got a little bit of slap, I guess. You got that slapping, right? Plucking or...
Plucking. Slapping is slapping.
There's a lot of things you can do. You could stick on this chord for hours. One way I used to practice is just really getting the hits down. So you want to figure out before you start playing this groove, like, where you want to put those hits. So you want to start with that. So it's really just 1, 2, 3, 4. You're plucking with all your fingers. And in between that, you're going to throw in this chuck, I guess. It's not really a chuck. It's like a rest. But you're using your thumb and your fingers to kind of emulate a percussive, like a drum sound. So you want to get that down. And that's going to be... what's driving the rhythm and holding the rhythm. That's kind of the base of the whole technique and the whole rhythm. So 1, 2, 3, 4. And you're going to be adding that palm mute / snare drum, we'll call it. 3, 4. Then it's gonna go back to the beginning, even though this all sounds the same. Then from there, you can start throwing in slides. Kalei and I like to do this often. What we do is we take C7. You're gonna do a slide up from B7. And a little slower. I'm not going to break down the whole chucking and plucking and stuff, so you just follow along with this. As good as gonna get for the explanation. So you gotta really feel it. That's the whole thing. It's all feeling.
I mean, it's all about like the accents for that, because it's kind of like a syncopated thing for the.
A lot of syncopation is involved. Right. So what you wanna in the back? What I'm thinking in my head is this rhythm: 2, 3, 4, 1. 2, 3, 4. It's kind of like a game because you're sticking the accents, the punches in between those mm-hmm. 1, 2, 3, 4s. So just do that, and then from there you can start layering and start building. Put that in a looper pedal. Then you can start soloing. That's going to be another technique. But yeah. Mm-hmm.
stuff like that. And all Kalei was doing was... You could do a hammer-on with, you know, if you bar the third fret and you just hammer on the rest of the chords for like a regular C or C7. And then, one thing I like to throw in, you know, if you want to kind of spice it up. So you have C7. What you're going to do is you're going to hammer on an A or shape. B flat. And that's, just imagine the G shape, but you're all the way up on the fifth fret now. So while you're doing that, you can throw that in. And that's, all you're doing is you're moving your bar up here now to the fifth fret and you're hammering on this. Or if you want to get technical, you can add the whole seventh chord. Oh. Yeah. We're not gonna go super heavy into funk this week, but we'll elaborate more as we get more into these techniques of the week. So.
I think I need to head out, guys. My daughter's alone.
Thank you so much, Peter.
And she's gonna have to let me in, so she's gonna have to come downstairs.
Oh, thank you, Peter.
We love you, buddy.
Thank you so much.
Doing awesome work.
Thank you, guys. On the website soon.
Yeah.
We will see you soon, and thank you so much. Keep spreading the aloha. Keep strumming your ukes. We need positivity in the world.
Yes. Yes.
And let us know however we can help with any of your ukulele needs. Aloha.